This episode of the Glass Blower's Companion is brought to you by Mountain Glass Arts. For the month of January 2020, Mountain Glass is offering their Boro sale. You can get Pyrex rod and tube at 40% off. No coupon code needed. All you have to do is go in there and pick out your glass and place an order. It's also a great time to order quantity in glass at 40% off. You can save a ton of money, have that glass put on a freight and have it shipped instead of having to buy individual cases. It'll save you a ton of money in shipping. Just as a thought there for you. And for all you beautiful soft glass nerds, they're having their jewelry making essentials sale, 25% off. And again, no coupon code needed. Just go in there and pick out your jewelry making essentials and you'll save 25% off at checkout. Also, for all you Boro artists, right now they're having a special Boro sale. Northstar and Troutman select seconds are 50% off. No promo code needed as well. We'll have all the links in the show notes for you. You can also go to mountainglass.com/sale, and they'll have the link right there for you that will show you what exactly the seconds are that are being offered in this sale. Again, Northstar and Troutman select seconds are 50% off. And for any other questions, comments, or concerns, make sure you go check out mountainglass.com. That's mountainglass.com. This is the Wise Guy Radio Show, a podcast dedicated to educating and inspiring through conversations with today's top talents in the world of glass.
Is the haunting spree, so hurry back, we would like your company.
Hey, what's happening? Welcome to episode 10 of A Glass Blower's Companion. This is your host, Jason Michael. Hope you are doing well. Today's episode is featuring Chris Piazza, who is making his fourth appearance. He is officially the first glass artist to make a fourth appearance on the show. And he's coming on this time around to talk about what has been going on over the last year and a half since he's been on last, covering some little bit of trade show talk. But really, our focus was talking about selling your glass on Facebook. And last time he was on, he had talked about a Facebook group that he had basically taken over, had been handed in a sense. And through some trials and tribulations and some Facebook policings, he's figured out some ways around some of the issues that they were dealing with in terms of selling their glass on Facebook. And so it was a good time for us to kind of catch up and talk. As now that 2020 is officially here, I have begun getting myself back on a regular basis on making functional work, making pipes and stuff. And kind of reinvent myself, as I know I talked about last year, was going to try to really go full force with it. But I needed to step back, kind of get some things in hand, as well as life got pretty interesting. You know, I got married here on New Year's Eve of this last year, or the first of this year, whichever you want to see it as. And so it just got settled in, and now things are settled in, and things are going pretty well. Now it's time to get my ball rolling in terms of my glass. So instead of just working on lines of work and focusing on the retail side or selling to shops, I'm experimenting in many different areas and venues, different areas, and not really putting all my eggs in one basket, but really diversifying where my work is going to go. And the reason I'm doing that, not only is it for myself to kind of feel out what's been going on, because it has been quite some time since I've actually gotten my hands out there into the functional scene, but also for you as an audience. I'm going to share this whole year is going to be all about my comeback in a sense, what I'm doing, what's going to be successful, what's not going to work, at least for myself. And I'm going to be sharing with you this whole journey that I'm going to be on. Things I tend to do on the show anyway is just share my journey, my personal journey. But this is going to be my my call to comeback journey, as well as getting prepared for Glass Vegas 2021. which is going on right now as I record this. I'm recording this on the 28th, and Glass Vegas is in full force right now. I was supposed to go out there this year. We had plans, already had everything set up with Glass Vegas out there. But then at the very last minute, my transmission in my car went out, and that was a lot of fun. And fortunately, I had a little bit of money put away, and also with the wife, her and I, just together as a team, made a decision to go ahead and just go get a car for myself, something I had to finance, which is always a pain in the ass to finance. But you do what you got to do, and so I have a reliable car. But that being said, that ate up the money I was going to be potentially using to fly out there. And her and I were actually going to go out there together. And I was going to go out there just to scout the show out, interview artists, interview smoke shops, really fill it out. But now that I'm not doing that, I have other things in the works to kind of get a feel of what's been going out there with some artists, including my brother, Lurker, who's out there right now. So that being said, I'm gearing up for 2021. I'm going to take you on my journey of me making a comeback through my glass line that I have, my Wise Guys. I'm going to be back creating those guys again, refining them a little bit more so. I'm getting back into really refining the steps of the processes when it comes to doing rigs and what have you, making sure my ring seals are clean, making sure that my handmade joints that I'm doing, my female banger hangers, are all clean. I finally got a brass tool, which I have never had before. I've always used graphite tools. And for those of us that use graphite, we all know that graphite wears out after a while. Things are no longer true. And because of that, I needed to step up my game and got some brass tools. So I got a hold of Mountain Glass, got some brass tools, and it's pretty good shit. It's actually on their website for this, the tool I got. There's a little video that they have through YouTube that I'll go ahead and, I think it was through Glasscraft. I don't remember who it was through, maybe Blast Shield. But it was a really simple setup of a video on making handmade female ground joints, which was pretty badass. And that's what I know how to make them, but I just had to refresh my memory. So I found their little video, and I'll put a link in the show notes for you guys for that. But other than that, you know, again, I'm looking at just sharing my journey. I'm going to be diversifying my line of work. I'm going to be not only working on functional stuff, but also non-functional work and my fine art, in a sense. And some other things behind the scenes I'm working on, including the online stuff, the website. My newsletter is in full force. I'm putting out a newsletter now every week. When a new episode posts, the episode link and everything will go on that newsletter, as well as updates of what's going on behind the scenes, some special links we have, the Patreon group I have. I am, as of this week, going to be getting back in there. I have a couple of videos I'm going to be posting up. I had a buddy of mine hit me up who had gotten some orders for some Gandalf Sherlocks, and I haven't made a Gandalf Sherlock in probably 5 years, and it was a lot of fun to actually make it. And I told him, hey, while I'm making this thing, I'll make a video for you. So those are the kind of things that are going to be in the Patreon group, or going to be tutorial videos. There's actually a bunch in there right now. But also, I'm going to be expounding upon these each episode. For those that listen to my budget episode on the Wise Guy Minute, I'm going to be expounding upon that by putting a video into the Patreon group on my process of filling out my paperwork. And a big thing I'm doing this year, too, with myself is just with the integrity of what I want to have with not only the show, but myself personally, is to practice what I'm preaching. So when I do have a sale, I'm going to be taking care of all my numbers, putting my stuff into a book, keeping track of my budget, putting money aside for reinvesting into the company, putting money aside for taxes, all that stuff. And I'm going to be covering that in more episodes of the Wise Guy Minute series. But specifically, I'm going to be putting these videos of me going through the process of filling out this paperwork and doing this kind of stuff into the Patreon group. I really want to focus on the Patreon group in more of a mastermind sense to share and to get feedback from you all on what I'm doing, but not only what it is that you do. I'm really curious in terms of how you manage your business, because business talk is important. It's a lot of things. Some people don't like talking business. I fucking love talking about business. I love talking numbers and marketing and sales and ideas. It just gives me a fucking boner. I mean, seriously, I love it. You'll hear me and Chris talking about it in this episode. I love talking business. And I get inspired, and then I get ideas, and then I'm going to share these ideas with you. So stay tuned for that. You can find the Patreon group online, and you can help support this show for as little as $1 a month. For that $1 a month, you'll have access to these videos I'm putting up there. The actual tutorial videos are going to be for those that are in the $5 and up month group. There's a $1, a $5, and a $10. And then the $10 group, I'm still going to figure out some things with that. I'm not really sure yet what I'm going to do. It's going to be an extra special thing, probably a one-on-one potential coaching call, something of that nature. But ideally, again, just for $1 a month, that's $12 a year, you'll have access to the Patreon group and also to the building a community. There's lots of different communities on through Facebook. They're huge and way saturated. And, you know, if you want to not deal with any kind of trolling and some BS out there, this Patreon group will be for you. It's going to be a very intimate group, whether we have 5 of us or 100 of us or whatever that's in there. It's going to still be an intimate group and no bullshit. And you know, I'm going to be pretty strict about what's going to be talked about in there, and you know, no trolling or name calling and that kind of shit. So you can go to patreon.com/wiseguyradio. I still need to update the name on that group, but that's what it is right now. And again, for as little as $1 a month, every little penny that goes towards the show helps support the show, helps upgrade my equipment, helps pay for travel expenses. So like for say Glass Vegas for next year, I'll be able to go out there and fly. I'm going to be going anyways, but it'd be awesome to have that covered through the support of the show. And so other than that, I think everything's been covered. Chris and I, again, we get in some deep talk about Facebook, and then we kind of get some sidetracked on some things that we talk about throughout the business aspect of things and marketing and how to successfully get yourself out there. And then we get back to the Facebook talk again. So I hope you enjoy this episode again with Chris Piazza. You can check him out there in the world of social media. He is on Instagram at Crispy Glass. I'll have his link in the show notes. And until next time, guys, take care of yourselves. We'll talk to you soon. Love you so much. Take care. Peace. What's going on, Chris? Welcome back to the show, dude.
Hey, dude. How you doing?
Good, man. So, this is, what, your third time on the show now, huh?
I think, I was trying to figure out, 3 or 4. Yeah. I think the last time was 3, so, something like that, 3 or 4.
Yeah, so I guess it's his 4th. So, last we had talked was you were coming back from the 2018 Glassroots after they were in Madison for their last year. And then just this recent 2019, they transitioned into Asheville. So I want to kind of talk about that because before you were growing your business, you're, you know, going from yourself to bringing some artists on to help with production, growing your lines, trying to figure out how to fill these big orders. And you got your system down in a sense to which direction to go instead of like focusing on just one pipe. You want to focus on one shop at a time and blah, blah, blah. So those that are new to Chris and being on the show, I'll have his past episodes in the show notes because it's very fascinating to hear a transition of going from a single glass blower to a company, in a sense, growing it, doing trade shows, figuring out your shit, and then to where you then transition to Asheville. And then later on in this episode, we're going to talk about selling glass through Facebook and some of the issues that you have found with Facebook policing, and also myself now with 2020, kind of reinventing my glass and getting myself back out there as a pipe maker. So yeah, man, stoked to talk about all this stuff.
Oh yeah, hell yeah, definitely. Yeah, 2018. I mean, that was kind of the end of having some guys in the shop, like you're saying. Like that was on the last podcast before that I was on, but yeah. So we kind of ended up coming back down to just being me and my long-term apprentice. And then we hit Glassroots Asheville, and you know, it was a first year show, and it's kind of an odd location, but like everybody was still there, but the buyers were a little light. And I think there were a lot of new buyers, which was interesting. Like it was a little overwhelming for a lot of the shops there, I think, because like, yeah, I mean, anybody that's been to their first, it's kind of like going to your first concert, your first, you know, first glass show. It's like, holy crap, there's so much here. And I feel like a lot of the shop owners had that experience. But as, you know, I think that'll, they got educated now. So now next year, I think they're going to be a lot more active. You know, a lot of the guys, like, you know, they were, you know, Mickelson's over in the corner, and they're just, blown away by seeing all of his work, and then they go spend a bunch of money on a bunch of stuff because first time they've ever seen any of this or any of that, and then they run out of money after they went through the first aisle,
right?
You know, and they, you know, they got 5 other aisles to go through and they already broke, you know. So I think there was a lot of education going on for a lot of them, from the conversations I had. But you know, we walked out of that show okay. It wasn't our best show, but it wasn't our worst show. Like you were saying, we ended up coming back down from having the 4 guys in the shop down to just 2 of us. But quite honestly, I figured out that I'd rather be working with guys outside of my shop. You know, over the years, I have over 100 stores that I sell to. And so, yeah, I still have an issue producing enough. So now I'm starting to kind of take care of some other guys, too.
Yeah, yeah.
I think it's kind of the best way to put it.
Yeah, yeah, which is killer.
Yeah, I think we all kind of find our niche in this industry, you know, and like I'm just, you know, I'll be the first to admit I'm not some heady artist. Like I am a proto machine pretty much, and that's okay. That's me. I also find that I'm a little bit more of a sales guy than I am an artist. So I've kind of found that like I can actually be helping other guys come up, you know, more than I can be making couple thousand dollar pieces. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and I guess in terms of like the return on your investment and your time wise, it could potentially be more beneficial for you as well in that route.
Definitely. It's rather than trading time for money on the torch, I can extrapolate that a little bit. And you know, I'm not, you know, obviously you don't make a lot reselling glass. It's just there isn't much margin in there.
Yeah.
But yeah, I can make a little bit extra there.
Yeah. And help other artists.
Exactly. I got a handful of guys that are just, you know, I'm finding the guys that, you know, that maybe they sell $1,500 a month, and now that they're with me, I'm buying $1,500 a month from them and consistent orders, and so now they're able to like spread their wings a little bit more. So it's nice. Guys are like, oh man, I'm about to buy a new torch, and it's like, that's awesome. That makes me feel so great that like, because I'm able to buy their glass, they're able to get a new torch and now step up and moving from a Red Max to a CC, you know, and now they're going to have some power, you know? So yeah, pretty cool.
Yeah. It's rad. So. Yeah. And while we're recording this too, it's the 27th of January, which Glass.vegas is going on right now too. You know, talking about trade shows and stuff, which you're not there. And we kind of talked, you know, kind of last week about the whole with Glass.vegas and the big trade show that it is, and that you're kind of staying away from that kind of a setup because you're not familiar with it for one, but also just because it's you know, where it is right now. I think it seems kind of difficult at times for some artists to be able to shuffle all the trade shows, you know, even throughout the year. They're so, you know, they're spread apart. Like Glass.roots and Glass.vegas are pretty much now spread apart from each other, like 6 months apart in a sense. Compared to say like Champs and Glass.roots, you know, with they seem to separate themselves apart from it now that they're in Asheville, but they're still kind of within a couple months, which can be difficult if you're trying to sell glass at both trade shows.
I think there's like a Champs every month these days.
Yeah, it seems just like it.
I mean, there's a Chicago Champs now, which is crazy. I mean, but yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah, there's a lot going, you know, and you know, Glass.vegas. I mean, it sounds cool. And you know, I could have got in on the first year. The problem that I saw was how big the booths are was a problem for me. Cause I come with, you know, 50 styles and 5 samples of each of the styles. And so I would have needed to buy 2 booths, and it was just too much. I just didn't see the potential, return when I'm spending $3,000 on 2 booths to be able to display everything, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, so. Exactly. Yeah,
but, you know,
it's interesting.
That's where Facebook comes in. You know, I mean,
yeah, exactly. Which is a good transition.
Right. I mean, I've found that, like, quite honestly, like I have not, I was thinking about, I was talking to a local shop because there's a guy I buy my vape juice from who, you know, obviously a shop in town. And so we were talking, and the last time that I've gotten in my car to go on sales was about 4 years ago. I haven't left my shop to do sales because now I got Facebook, and between Glass.roots and Facebook, I'm pretty much golden. And then just recurring orders. So
yeah. That's awesome. I think my biggest excuse for going on the road to my one shop that I have over at Blaze, and shout out to Blaze over in Cocoa Beach, is because it's on the beach and it gives us, my wife and I, a chance to go take an hour away from Orlando and go have a date night, you know, kind of thing.
There you go.
Go sell,
and it's a write-off, too.
Yeah. You know, I didn't think about that. That's a great idea.
Yeah, it is.
I didn't think about that.
I mean, you know, you have to go get a hotel too, because, like, I mean, an hour away, that's pretty far. You know, just throw it on the business card.
Yeah. Great idea. I'm writing notes right now about that, because that's the shit that I used to do, you know, and now that this 2020 is my comeback year in a sense, you know, I'm not rusty per se, but now that, you know, I'm filing my taxes again this year and everything else with the business. Okay. That is all important stuff.
Oh, taxes. Not fun.
Yeah, no shit. I know, right? Yeah. My goal for this quarter is I just did my first one I released last week on doing a budget, but to really help people get their financial houses in order so that, you know, you're on schedule for paying quarterly taxes and not paying 10 grand at the end of the year kind of shit.
Yep. Yeah. Yep. I'm still at the 10 grand at the end of the year type of thing.
Yeah.
I mean, but I would like to get on to quarterlies. I mean, I have too many moving parts. We're going to be buying a new house and going that route. And so, yeah, need all my cash. So I'll be filing an extension this year. But
yeah, yeah. Do what you got to do. And that's, you know, it helps. Do you have an accountant that you work with?
No, my dad is a CPA. So
oh, yeah,
he's
that's
taught
right.
me all this stuff. Yeah,
that's right.
So I'm pretty good on the finances side.
Yeah, yeah. That's so helpful.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, another talk for another day.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, man. So the Facebook group. So I know, like, last time we had chatted, you were handed off in a sense a Facebook group for the, you know, the pipe sales and stuff. And
yeah,
you had mentioned
Glass Blowers to store owners for anybody that's looking for it.
Yeah, yeah. So to get in that group, you just had to go in there and ask for a request to join the group.
So you'd actually have to message me directly, and then I can get you in because we're going to get into this. Because of all the Facebook restrictions, we had to go secret. So now it's not actually searchable. So it's just growing through word of mouth from here on.
Okay.
And so you have to have.
Is it so? Because I know, like, with YouTube, for instance, right now, with their whole new minor policy that they have, whether they say if your content's adult friendly or not, and it's like it's fucking up a lot of people out there that have child friendly YouTube channels, but they also, there's so many restrictions now. And I know Facebook is on that same realm, you know. Instagram is a little more free, but people are still getting accounts closed. But it seems like Facebook is even more stringent with their rules these days.
Oh, yeah, definitely. We were finding, so we are technically a sales, or so we're technically a discussion group, according to Facebook now. We were a sales group. So any guys that have been selling, well, pretty much anything on Facebook, what you do is in a sales group is you put the item for sale, you put the price, and then you put a description, you put pictures. So Facebook AI has gotten so good that it has, well, and bad, it has been the moment you set a sales post, it would shut you down. It would say break a terms of service and you wouldn't even be notified. You just put a post up and a couple hours later, you'd be like, why hasn't anybody even liked this post? Is it that shitty? And then you go on and you're like, oh, it's been flagged. Nobody's seen it. So what we ended up doing was actually turning it into a discussion group. So now you post a discussion and it's a less likely for you to get a terms of service violation. And then there's little tricks that, you know, don't use dollar signs when you're posting in sales groups. And then some guys actually post the pictures in the comments. Those are just a couple little tricks in order to if you're getting flagged. So
interesting.
Yeah.
I know there was a group I posted in last year helping somebody out, and I actually in the photo itself I added the prices into the picture, right. not actually in my write up of the comments. You know what I mean? Like, is that kind of stuff helpful, or does that still get flagged?
Yeah. Yep. That's definitely helpful. That's definitely another trick that you can do. As long as there's no dollar sign in the comments, and then if you even want to go that much farther, putting the price in the picture, and you can get like a meme generator on your phone, and you can add, at least that's how I had to do it, to be able to add numbers to it. I don't know, iPhones, maybe you guys can do that easier. Yeah, you can add that to the picture too. And then that way you won't get flagged.
Hell yeah.
Go on. One other thing, for the longest time, I was putting grams for how much my pieces weigh, because like my fume honeycomb spoons are 100 or over 100 grams, which is obviously a selling point, right? So I was doing that, and then I started getting flagged for having grams or even having a G next to a set of numbers. Because, yeah, it's assumed that it's, selling grams is something else.
Yeah, exactly. So, huh.
Yep.
Fascinating.
Some weird shit, man.
Yeah, no shit. I know with the iPhone, I have an app called PixArt, and it's a free app. They always want to have you buy the upgraded, you know, whatever version of it. But you can insert pictures and numbers and all kind of shit into it. It's helpful. I mean, in a sense, you're just like posting, you know, creating yourself a catalog, and then you're putting up your catalog on Facebook, you know, in a sense.
Definitely. Yeah, and if anybody's not tried the Facebook sales groups, I mean, I've done really, really well in there. I mean, like I said, like I haven't left the shop because I can just post on Facebook, and most of the time, you know, I sell whatever I have up there in like a day or two. Now the keys to that is obviously good pictures, and, you know, so not taking a picture of like, you know, a handful of pieces all scattered over your bench with a bunch of broken glass around it. Like, that doesn't fly in these groups. Like, you need to actually take the time to set up a nice picture, like you're saying, like a catalog. Like, you need to take that time, and then that's the glass that sells. Like, a long time ago, you know, you used to be able to just take a picture of your glass in a case. Just like if you were going to a shop and you're opening a case, like, I was just snapping pictures like that, and that worked for a while, but it's kind of leveled up in the groups now. Like, that doesn't work anymore. I see guys posting stuff like that, and, you know, it's just sitting there. So you definitely have to step it up a little bit. Like, look at other people's posts and see which ones have recently sold, or recently, you know, somebody's put, you know, text that says sold, and just kind of see what they did versus, you know, the stuff that's just sitting there. There's no excuse for not selling on Facebook, basically, in my opinion. It's just, you're doing something wrong if you're not able to sell on there. That's just what I see. Not to be too harsh about it.
It's interesting. And so in terms of like product that you're selling, do you recommend, like, say you have a catalog that you put together and you don't have inventory necessarily that you keep on hand, but you make as you go, you know, in terms of sales, is that one way to go about it? Or should you always have, you're posting your stock that you have?
For Facebook, you really need the stock. I have another group that's Facebook, glass blowers with catalogs to store owners, and that never really took off. It seems like people, and it kind of makes sense, right? Like, some, you know, honestly, there's a good percentage of the shop owners have experienced shitheads in our industry that screwed them over, right? So, like, they aren't super interested in putting in an order for you to go and make, right? Like, they want to see what they're buying. Now, so pre-making everything and then posting it is the way to go. I've experienced, in my experience on Facebook, sometimes if you post 50 Fritz spoons and it sells right away, somebody else will jump in because they're able to see 50 uniform pieces and say, hey, can I put an order in for 50? So, like, sometimes that'll happen. But yeah, if you just post a picture of 5 Fritz spoons and say, hey, I'm taking orders for 50 or 100, chances are it's not going to happen because you don't have a relationship with them yet, right? Like, they're willing to take a risk on looking at pieces that they're going to buy, but not as much just like an order for you to make afterwards. Does that make sense?
Oh, it makes total sense. Yeah.
After you create that relationship, now cultivate it, and then you can get orders. So, like, after somebody buys from me on there, I'll send them a catalog and I'll keep in contact with them. And, you know, a couple months later, hey, like, just wanted to check in, how are those selling, blah, blah, blah. Oh man, they're selling great. Yeah, I'll take another 50, you know? So that's kind of how I've built up such a customer base at this point. But that initial, yeah, you definitely have to pre-make it.
Yeah, it's a great idea. Now, in terms of like having your stuff, you know, so you sell an order to a shop, your stuff looks similar to other artists out there stuff, Goliath's production, whatever, you know, Fritz Spoons or whatever. Do you recommend, like, you know, having a small sticker made or something that's a standout so that you can call the shop and say, hey, you know, how's my stuff doing? And they will recognize.
100%. And I also have a greenrushbranding.com. He's a fellow glassblower / entrepreneur. He has his own side business making decals, and just ask him for the same ones that Crispy gets and he'll know. They're like these little tiny circles. I never remember what size they are. They're like 1/4 inch or something like that. And they're just these little circles I put on every single piece that goes out of my shop. Yep.
Cool.
Definitely.
I know that, but I'm just asking for the layman in a sense.
Oh yeah, totally. Well, and I love anytime I can shout out Green Rush Branding. I mean, he's awesome. Matt is just, he's the shit. And I don't even know what I'm ordering. I just shoot him a text. I'm like, hey, I need more of what I got last time. And he's like, okay. And he just sends me an invoice and ships them out in a couple of days. So yeah, he's great. He's awesome.
Hell yeah. So speaking of invoicing, when you're, you know, taking a sale on Facebook, what do you recommend in terms of, you know, sending invoices and getting paid?
Right on. So I honestly use PayPal. I still haven't had an issue, knock on wood. But the trick that I've found is I do not put any information in my PayPal invoice. I just do a money request. And then, after I get paid, I send them. So I use QuickBooks personally. And I send an actual invoice, email when I'm about to ship, I also leave a printed invoice in the box. And anybody that's not doing that, really, it sucks that it's quote unquote corporate or too businesslike, but like, that's the way to do it. I mean, as a buyer, when I am starting with a new guy and he sends me an invoice or like a, you know, handwritten piece of paper, it's like, I know right away that it's like, well, at least I suspect that I might have issues making orders later on. Right. Like, mm-hmm. I don't know if, you know, there's no records on his end and what he charged me. And like, I just feel like there's a little less professionalism to it. So like, I know that I've gotten complimented by having a paper QuickBooks invoice by my customers, by new customers. Like, hey, wow, this is really professional. Really like look forward to working with you more. Cause obviously like, you know what you're doing and I don't know what the fuck I'm doing. But it looks better.
Yeah, right? and that's the whole thing, man. That's the perception, because like I know back in the day when I was first selling glass, and I would have a carbon copy. I'd get my shops, and they loved that fact that I even had that, you know, because I had a copy for myself. They had a copy, and then I started using FreshBooks, which eventually I stopped because they were like a PayPal kind of thing where they recognized their algorithms or their computer AI recognized, you know, a pipe outright, you know. But just to be able to say, hey, what's your email? I'll shoot you an email real fast with, you know, my thing. But I agree. It's a perception of being professional. And, you know, that's the biggest secret to business, period, is making your customers think that you're professional. Yeah. Everything, follow-ups, being on time, being consistent. It's also helpful to brand yourself. You know, you put your little brand on your invoice. They're always going to see that brand and they're going to recognize you as a brand, not just as some janky glass blower in your studio, in your garage, but as like a brand of a company, which is huge.
Right. Right. And that's just kind of, you know, that's what happens when an industry evolves. Right. I mean, yeah, I used to do the same thing with carbon copy back in the day. And that, like you said, like we stood out just by having a carbon copy.
Yeah.
And that was a way to stand out then. And now it's just kind of leveled up. Now we need to do, you know, a nicer, more professional invoice. Always look bigger than you are. And, you know, with how many glassblowers there are these days, I mean, the flood of Instagram and everybody wants, you know, I mean, I find it funny watching how many torches go up for sale because of how many, you know, it's a shame, quite honestly, because it's not that hard to stand out in this industry. There's, you know, the bar is already pretty low. If we were getting into other industries, it would be expected to have a paper invoice. Now, if you have a paper invoice, like you are ahead of so many. It's crazy.
Yeah.
Right? Like,
yeah.
So.
Yeah. And what I find interesting too, like even the smoke shops are evolving, you know, in a sense too, but like email is still such a big thing in the business world, but in our industry, it's not, you know?
Totally. Yep.
It's so weird.
Oh, yeah. Go ahead.
Because I'm going back, like doing a weekly newsletter through my podcast and stuff, like just, you know, promoting Mountain Glass's sales are doing and just like the next episode of the show and what have you. And even like the open rates are like maybe 10-20% potentially. And I've got like almost 400 emails that go out at one time. I'm still learning like the proper ways because I think some are going to junk files instead. But, you know, if you're able to send your invoices, and of course, as we're, you know, not only was my lawn service next door going, but now I got the garbage guy coming by the house.
I can't hear it.
Okay, cool. But you know, I think as business owners, we can create habits for our smoke shops. You know, to say, hey, I've sent you an email invoice. Make sure you check that email. Because then, like, the next month, you can send them, hey, here's my newest line of work I'm doing. And they're getting used to checking their emails all the time. You know, just kind of creating that sense. Like, I had Gibson on my last episode as an interview, and he was talking about where he's over in Canada. He didn't have a scene, and he actually had to create a scene there. You know, the whole build it, right, they will come kind of concept. And it's the truth with our industry. You know, we're still a young, like this, you know, the United States, we're still a young country. This industry is still a young industry. You know, constantly evolving. And if you can be someone that can step up into this industry and help to create the next level, you know, the bar higher in a sense, because like you're saying, you know, we have a low bar set in this industry, and it's sad, you know, it sucks.
Right, right. Well, I mean, you know, like 10 years ago, we couldn't use our real names, right? Yeah. Like now a lot of the big guys are, and that's kind of the evolution. I mean, we just came out of the woods just a couple of years ago. So that little bit of standing up, getting ahead of the curve is going to make a huge difference. I mean, getting an LLC, you know, little things like that, becoming a real business. It doesn't cost that much and it's not that hard, but it'll pay dividends. It'll pay, you know, huge rewards just in professionalism. So
yeah.
Yeah. Yep. And then, and that shows on Facebook, right? Like, you know, because Facebook's tricky, right? Like it's all social media. If you screw somebody over, your name's going to go on blast, but the opposite happens too. You know, when you are a consistent supplier, you know, to the group and posting regularly, people will notice, and other shops will get into the comments and say, hey, you know, I've ordered from this guy a bunch of times. It's great work. And then another shop owner is going to see that and they're going to buy your stuff, you know? And so any of that professionalism, you know, maybe that piece of paper that had the invoice properly done, or, you know, whatever else, other little thing, having the stickers on the pieces, any of these, you know, shit, packing your stuff nicely so that when they open it, it's not just a mess, right?
Yeah. Not a bunch of fucking paper towels.
Right. Exactly. Getting bubble wrap, like go on Amazon, buy bubble wrap, like, or whatever you're going to do. Like, and that stuff makes your buyer like appreciate working with you, and they're going to help you out because we're all in this together. We're quite a small family when it really comes down to it.
Yeah.
You know, everybody's willing to help, especially when the guy's in, you know, the buyer's in Florida and he knows that there's other buyers in New York. They're not competing with each other. They just want to help the glass blower out. Right.
So, yeah, exactly. Yeah. And word of mouth is still like the number one advertising out there ever, whether it's good or bad. Yep. It's going to make you successful or it's going to fuck you, whichever way, you know?
Yep. I had an experience with, we've talked about Promopice before, which is one of my products that got bit off by, you know, Grav Labs. And when I sent the stuff, then my buyer ended up getting a email from Grav, and the price was half the price that I was charging, right? Because they're import. So when that happened, I got blasted. I got just completely blasted in this private buyers group. Well, I'd already built up such a reputation with all these other people that they all stood up for me, and I wasn't even in the group. I started getting screenshots of that group and all these buyers saying, hey, you know, just defending me. And it was awesome, you know, and that's because if you're consistent and reliable, I mean, you can get that. And I'm not trying to gloat about myself. I'm just trying to say that this can be done by anybody. I'm just Joe Schmo in Chicagoland, like, you know,
yeah,
nobody big.
No, but you're setting a good example, when that's the important part. You know, it's like for the younger glassblower, they need to find someone that they can look at that's a good example on how to run your shit properly.
Right.
You know.
Right.
And you're a good example, which is why you're on the show for the fourth time.
Well, and that's why I love your show, because you actually, you know, that was an awesome podcast last week about Canada. That was a cool, and I'm going overseas for that other show. Was it Ireland or something?
Yeah, Scotland. Like, yeah.
Just Scotland. Yeah, I mixed the two. And I mean, I just, yeah, I love your podcast. So
thanks, man.
Definitely. Spreading the good word.
Yeah, trying to. Because for me, like, you know, like I grew, my dad and my mom both were always like, you know, like don't do as I do as I say kind of concepts, you know. And recently listening to a lot of different leaders out there in the world, they're, you know, even yesterday listening to a show, and he was saying, you know, how that was something his mom always said, but his philosophy is like, do as I do and as I say, if you want, but mostly as I do, like lead by example kind of idea. And right. for like a long time, I just, you know, I'd always say I need to practice what I preach and just create my own good habits, because I know what the fuck it is I should be doing. However, I wasn't always good at doing those things. But this 2020, now that I'm getting myself back into the pipe game, you know, I want to make sure that I'm also setting a good example as well. Not just by the show and just by lip service, but by actually physically doing it. You know, so I'm going to start doing a lot more posts on the podcast page, the Wise Guy Media, or the Glassblower's Companion page, showing what I'm doing. You know, I'm going to put a budget form up there, which I just did an episode on creating a budget. So I'm going to be posting today, like, hey, here's a basic example on how you can set a budget for yourself, so you know how much money that you should be making to pay for your bills personally and for your studio bills, and also put money in savings and pay your taxes.
Yep.
You know, and if you ain't making enough money, then go get a fucking part-time job. It's not that difficult. Or Uber for a couple months, you know,
just
whatever.
Just work harder. Because it can be done. This isn't that hard. We can all do it.
Yeah,
we can all do it. If you have the budget, you have all this stuff, you know, and you actually work, this can be done. And you don't have to punch a clock. So.
Yeah. Yeah, speaking of punching a clock, man, I punch a clock. And sometimes I love it because I love what I do and where I work. But then sometimes I'm like, oh, man, these handcuffs sometimes suck.
Well, and you're blowing glass, and you're where you're punching your clock. You're not going to flip burgers.
Yeah, exactly. So. Yeah, it's a little different.
Yeah, you got a pretty good gig.
Yeah, it's still a blessing for sure. But you know, you know, my heart's in the pipe game, and it has been from day one. And it's like it's such a weird dichotomy for myself. It's just like this. I got the devil and the angels on my shoulders, you know, and they're both pulling me. And like the devil's the pipe game, and the angel's me working over at the mouse house, which is kind of the devil too, you know. It's kind of like, you know, which I want to do both, and I know, like, it's again, it's just the freedom to do what it is that we want to do, and that's the beauty of being a pipe maker or just an artist in general, is being able to do what the fuck it is we want to do, you know.
Totally.
That's the part that always pulls on my heart a little bit. It's like, well, I could wake up today and just go to my own studio and do my own art, but then, you know, the consistency of a paycheck on a 401k and health insurance is beneficial.
Those are nice things. Those are nice things for sure.
Yeah.
I don't know. In the future, I want to talk more to artists in general, and just like this whole idea of like trading time for art, and everybody having this problem with it. But to me, it's like, you're either trading time for a paycheck, or you're trading time to make your art, which becomes a paycheck. And like, either way, you're trading time for something. And I don't know. I just would rather be doing what I want to do. Or, I mean, I wouldn't mind getting back into the scientific glass world, because I'd get a paycheck, a 401k, and all that stuff again. But, you know, I don't want to go get a normal job. I mean, if it's glass related, I'm okay with it, you know?
Yep.
But who knows?
Yeah, man, it's interesting. I've talked to a couple of different people at work that are scientific glass blowers, and just the way things are changing, you know, out there in that game, like they're kind of going back to the scientific glass blower for product instead of having things machine made, because they need that fine tuned hand quality eye of the human compared to the computer cranking out this, you know, mass production stuff. It's interesting.
Yep, they're having the same issue though that we are, you know, when it comes to import stuff. I mean, all the plants are going overseas, you know, and they're having a lot of that problem too. The place I used to work, a lot of the work went over to Mexico, you know, and so, you know, they're having similar issues. I mean, as well,
yeah.
Just like us. So, but we're still surviving, you know. I think that the American glassblower can still succeed regardless of what China's doing. Conversation I was having actually with my dad about it, and crazy that I can actually talk pipes with my dad, because when I started, absolutely wouldn't. But you know, he was saying, he's like, you know, if you really think about it, the consumer that's purchasing a import piece of glass isn't your consumer anyways, so it doesn't even, they're not really competing with you. It looks like they are, but they're not. Like a person buying, you know, a person buying a used Ford Pinto is not a competitor for Mercedes, right? Like it's they're just a different client. They're not even a customer,
yeah.
Not even a potential customer. And it was just interesting, just as far as everybody's bitching about China and all that stuff. I'm not worried about it. So
yeah, because like there's a guy I was listening to one day when I was getting the podcast started, and he was talking about, you know, not being worried about downloads and numbers and people listening to your show or people complaining about your show, because if people are complaining about your show, that means that your show isn't for them specifically,
right?
You know, and exactly. And you can't worry about that kind of shit, even though it's easier said than done at times, but still, you know, it's like, sure, we want to all make China killers and compete with the China market, but really it's like, okay, why don't we just make affordable pipes for a smoke shop to buy, right, instead of worrying about selling them shit that they're gonna make them stop buying the Chinese glass? Because in all reality, the majority of smoke shops out there have to have some kind of import in their shop to sustain, to be able to buy the American glass blower stuff,
right?
You know,
right,
in a sense.
Yep. Yeah, definitely. And yeah, like you said, like I don't call my stuff import killers, and that's cool. It's a great marketing tactic, right? Like that, the guys that started doing that, it's a good move. Mm-hmm. But for me, it's like, no, I just make affordable pipes. I make stuff that's under $10. I make stuff that's around 15 or so that is going to be less than $40 for the retail customer. And that's within a realm of affordability, you know, and yeah, that's just crush that out. So
yeah, I think it's definitely all a lot of mindset.
What?
I think it's a lot mindset type of situation too, you know, having the mindset that you're just creating an affordable something for a shop to buy, not just that you're having anxiety on whether or not you're competing with the Chinese market.
Right, right. Yep. It's not worth the energy. It's a waste of energy. And put that energy into your glass and you're going to do better.
Yeah, exactly. Definitely. Yeah, so that being said, you know, with the Facebook groups, you know, those are they, when they're buying stuff, you know, are they looking for everything in terms of high end, low end, you know, what do you recommend, you know, the average glass blower to really promote and lines wise to show on there?
So what I've seen is it kind of the gamut, right? Like almost anything will sell. If you can get around a $300 to $500 purchase, it does really well, whether that's two pieces or 50 pieces. That price point does pretty well when you're first getting going, because people want to test you out, you know, especially when you're new to the group. Once you're more established, you know, I sell 100 packs of $15 spoons pretty frequently, which is, you know, a great sale to have, a $1,500 sale, and I don't leave my shop. But then, you know, higher end stuff, it does well. I more so like if you have something that's different, Jay Brown Glass, buddy I met at Glassroots, he does these like cool electroforming and strange shapes and some sandblasted with some different symbols on it and stuff. You know, he's doing pretty good because it's an affordable price range. Like you're going to definitely compete a little bit more on price because you're not walking into a shop as an individual glass blower and the guy hasn't seen a glass blower in 2 weeks. Right. So like you're definitely competing a lot more. So price is going to be a lot more important. But at the same time, you're not having to get into your car. You're not taking time off the torch. You're not spending gas, you know, so you have to factor all that stuff in and be willing to bring your price down a little bit. Does that make sense?
Yeah, totally. Like, yeah. So and so then if you're setting a price point, do you recommend then kind of going through the group page and seeing what's being sold and what they're being sold at price wise and not undercutting, you know, obviously, but like staying in that ballpark of pricing?
I would definitely. Yeah. I mean, that, you know, that's kind of the name of the game. You definitely have to see where people are. And, you know, I can get an extra dollar for my Fritz spoons because the color goes to the end of the mouthpiece. So like, don't think that, oh, man, I'm seeing Fritz spoons for $7 just because, you know, or $6 and like, oh man, I can't get to that price. Like if your quality is a little bit higher, make sure your pictures show it and you'll get that extra dollar or two, you know? So you're going to compete on quality and on price, but price is definitely, you know, going to be a factor.
Yeah. So, yeah, absolutely. So just kind of thinking here too, like, you know, so I'm new guy going into this group. Nobody knows who the fuck I am. I mean, for me, potentially people are going to know who I am just because I've been in the industry for 20 years. But, you know, some new guy comes in, right. You know, and they want to show off their work and they have a small line of glass. Do you recommend putting together like a like an introductory package, you know, like a miscellaneous things, like a Chillum and a Spoon and maybe a couple Sherlock's and a couple Bubblers, you know, whatever their lines and stuff are. And then maybe offering like a introductory discount, like say, hey, you know, first time buyers of my stuff, I'll offer you, you know, 10% off or something like that. Or should you just go in there with like just your normal base prices?
Well, so that can be done. I see people doing it. I don't see those packs sell as well. I think the reason is when you see one Chillum, one Sherlock, and one Spoon as an introductory package, they don't see what your consistency is if they wanted to buy 20 Sherlocks. You know what I'm saying? Yep. So like if you like, so I found that consistency and, you know, maybe a 10 pack of Fritz, you know, a 10 pack of Spoons, Chillums, a 10 of each, like that could do okay. Not one of each.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Yep. So that people can see it. And then, you know, definitely, especially when you're starting out, be consistent. Nobody wants to work with somebody that posts once and then they disappear for 8 weeks and then they post again. Like, it's just, it can happen if your prices are phenomenal and your quality is over the top and it really shows you got great pictures, like all of that, like it can work. But I find that like I have done pretty well with consistency, and the guys that start posting consistently is a huge point to create comfort for them as buyers.
So, that makes sense. So when you say consistently, like what do you mean? It's like once a week?
Like once a week? Yeah. Yeah, once a week. And I mean, at the, you know, you can do more than once a week if you're selling. Like if you got 100 Fritz spoons in you know, pre-made, and you're putting up 20 packs, and a 20 pack sells on Monday, post another 20 pack on Tuesday, and that can build your reputation a lot faster too. You know, so feel free to post as much as you can. That's more the better. Don't post, you know, at least in my group, you're only allowed to post once a day unless it sells, then you can post again, because we don't want people spamming. You know, we don't, you know, don't post, you know, 40 posts in a row of one spoon each. Like you're going to get, yeah, that's not going to be all right. But consistently. So whatever that means, like a couple times a week, once a week, just don't do it like, you know, once and then be like, oh, it didn't work. And then 2 months later, try it again. Oh, it didn't work. Well, nobody knows who you are, so nobody's going to buy from you.
Right, right. So, in that terms then, so say you have a variety of shit you want to sell into a group, and then, you know, you have your posts. And then you mentioned earlier about posting pictures in the comments. So is that one way to go around having to post, you know, if you have like five pictures you want to put up, you know, so doing five posts, you do one post, but you put the five pictures into the main,
into the comments.
In the comments, okay.
Yeah, you can do that. I mean, you know, pictures in the post, give it a try, because, you know, that's kind of not super clear on whether Facebook's going to block you or not. Some guys are putting it in the comments just to be extra careful, but you can post all five pictures as like a little album when you make a discussion post. And then you just tag your five pictures and it'll all post them up.
Right.
So if you see that that's causing an issue, which it happens for some but not others, it's just not clear on why, then post it in the comments. And yeah, post all five pictures in the comments. And you know, also a little tip about all of it is put a price up in the post. I mean, unless like you're making some super crazy shit that people really want to like take the time to reach out to you about, more so than not, if it's just production, like put the price in the post, because people are just, they don't want to take the time to communicate with you. They want to see, okay, this is this much, $450, like with, you know, shipping included. Cool. I'll take it. It's a lot. They don't want to, PM me for pricing. And it's like just a waste of my time. I don't want to worry about it. So that's something that also make sure to do. Post the price in the post.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, it makes perfect sense. So I guess in a sense, to have like a post that may not get taken down is just to ideally, in the initial conversations thread or post, whatever, write your description of what you're posting, and then underneath that in the comments, and you can then post the pictures of what it is.
Yeah, you can do that. Yep. And then, yeah. And, You can post the price in the picture, in the comments too, if you want to be careful. You know, just don't use dollar signs in the main part and you should be fine.
Right. Like in the post, you can say like, you know, A is, you know, Rap and Rake Sherlock's 50 pack. And then in the comment, you can have the picture with it having A, so people know that that's correlated with each other.
You could do that. Yep. Yep. Definitely. Definitely. Yeah. It's all about like kind of variables, right? Like you got to just try it and then see like, okay, well, you know, one thing to look for is, do you have a dollar sign there? Do you have the word grams in there? You know, and pull that one piece out and see if it gets flagged. And if it doesn't get flagged, you're good. If it gets flagged, okay, go back to it. Okay, now I need to move the price into the comments. And then, okay, I'm still getting flagged. Like, you know, is there something else going on? Like, you know, maybe put your pictures in the comments and now you shouldn't get flagged. If you're still getting flagged there, honestly, just shoot me a message. Let me look at your post, because it can get kind of confusing. But for the most part, people have been pretty good lately now that not using dollar signs. It's a discussion group. A lot of that stuff, we've worked past it pretty well for now, until the next iteration of Facebook AI comes out. And then we need to go build our own app.
Yeah.
And have our own social network.
Yeah.
We'll get there eventually.
Yeah. Something I was wanting to do a couple of years back, create an online marketplace like the Etsy of the pipe game.
Yeah. I think a lot of us were trying that. Yeah. I don't think any of us actually pulled it off.
No, I stopped just because of legal, you know, implications that could potentially go down with, you know, federal laws and bullshit, not wanting to get myself, right, you know, in trouble. So once things are federally legal, I'm sure Joe Blow McGillicuddy from fucking every corner of the country is going to have their own online marketplace, you know, in a sense, and we'll see which one actually sticks.
Yep, and I'll be there.
Yeah, you and me both. We'll have to tag team it and do it together.
Yeah, hell yeah, totally. One other thing that, so some of our buyers are in Canada, some of them are in Alaska and Hawaii, so I personally include shipping in my price, so I say, you know, whatever, $500 shipped, but I learned the hard way to make sure that I put in parentheses to the continental U.S. There was one buyer in Alaska that bought a $300 pack from me, and I ended up having to eat $75 in shipping or whatever, because I ship with UPS. I hate the post office. I should have just gone post office. But so make sure to put a parentheses if you're going to include shipping, only the continental. Another little tip. So
yeah, it's great. Yeah, and that being said, when you're calculating the cost of what it costs you to make a pipe, you need to also include that, the shipping cost, you know, even if it's in a 10 pack or individually, break it down if you have, however you got to go about it, you know, it's important. Because I know a lot of people that when they buy the raw materials, they're not taking the shipping cost into consideration. They're just looking at the sales price or whatever they paid for it. You know, even when you buy it on sale, you can't price it at, oh, I got this for, you know, 30% off. You got to, you know, make sure that thing's valued at what the full price of what that tubing is going to cost you if it's not on sale, and add shipping to it.
Totally, totally. Otherwise, you're not getting any benefit of the sale.
No, you're just giving shit away.
Yep, yep. Yeah, and I, you know, I factor just in my big numbers. You know, we could do a budget time, another conversation, but like I factor about 5% of my sales is shipping cost. You know, so yeah. I just factor that in. I do free shipping over $500. That $300 one was an anomaly, but yeah, that's just what I do. So
yeah, that's good.
Yep. Yeah, just like to make things as easy as possible, because like these days with Amazon, with all these other things, like I like my buyer to know what they're paying, not what they're paying plus some question mark amount that they're going to get charged for shipping. You know, it I feel like that helps with my sales too. So
do you then in turn like help the shop price your stuff out, or you just say fuck it and leave it up to them, like they're just going to price it?
Oh, my catalog has an MSRP.
Yeah, okay, mine too.
Yep. And I throw a catalog in every order that I ship out. I mean, that's just just the cost of my shipping too. So
yeah, catalog, stickers, business cards.
Yep.
You know, whatever you can do.
Definitely.
So they remember your face and your name and your, it's not even really your face, but you know, your brand.
Totally.
In a sense.
Yep.
And if you're, you know, there's like, if you don't have a graphic or a logo, there's like 99 designs. There's so many different companies out there that for $5, you know, there's that, I forget the hell it's called, what, five something, Fiverr, I think it's called.
Fiverr, yep.
Yeah, you can have like a logo made for you, you know, super cheap shit, or just contact me and or you and we'll do it for you for a couple thousand dollars.
I like it. Hell yeah. Done. No problem.
Yeah,
it'll be really good too.
Yeah, exactly.
No, yeah, I think Facebook is phenomenal. I'm looking forward to you joining the groups and getting you plugged into these. And yeah, I mean, anybody that wants some help with it, you know, I'm Crispy Piazza on Facebook, and just shoot me a message and, I'll get you guys into the groups.
Hell
and
yeah.
I have to check. You might be able to actually invite people now that you're in my group.
Okay.
I think that people that are in the group can invite others. So I think they could reach out to you too. And you could easily just hit invite and click up and bring them in.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Sweet.
Yep.
Yeah. So I'll put the link for the group in the show notes so people can easily access it and find it out there. And since it is a hidden group.
Perfect.
And,
perfect.
We'll go from there with it.
Awesome.
So, but yeah, man, thanks so much for coming on and talking about this stuff. Cause I know it's like, you know, like you're saying with the Amazons and all the things that we are competing with in a sense, cause there are pipes out there. There's pipes on Etsy, you know, you name it. There's platforms out there that I mean, there's a category on Etsy that says glass pipes. It's just kind of weird how they run and police their stuff. You know, you can't show carbs and that kind of shit. It's fucking strange.
Right.
So, you know, we got lots of competition, but at the same time, we shouldn't worry about the competition because we should just be competing with ourselves and being the best we can be.
Definitely. And anybody that puts in the work can do it. I mean, there's no question about it. You know, we're not anybody special. You know, we just put in the work.
Yeah.
That's why we're where we are. And anybody else can do it too.
And let's raise this bar, Jesus.
Yeah. yep. Let's be a little more professional. I mean, that's going to be who stands out. That's going to win. You know, there's no question that federal legalization is going to happen. I mean, it's just a matter of time at this point. And when that happens, the professionals are going to be the ones that stand out. I mean, it's, you know, it's going to be a shame. And I'm going to be buying up a bunch of used torches and bringing guys in because, you know, there's going to be a lot of people that aren't going to be doing it.
Yeah.
And professional shops are going to be. You know, and watch out where your carbs are. Don't send carbs that have little, you know, nicks on them that are sharp. You know, watch all that shit. I've gotten so much glass from people. Like, just polish the damn carb. You know, like little things. It's just crazy.
Yeah.
So that's going to be level up. Level up.
It's all in the details. That's for sure.
Yep.
Hell yeah.
Hell yeah.
Again, man, thanks so much. And look for the link in the show notes if you're interested in getting your glass on Facebook and selling to all these shops. What's there now, like 6,000 or 3,000 or something? What's the number in there?
There's like 3,500 in my group, and then a buddy of mine's group has like 12,000. I can get you in on that one too.
Yeah,
yep.
There you go. And there's like 100,000 smoke shops just in my neighborhood, so there's yep, there's no yep. reason you can't sell your glass, folks. Get her done.
Nope, none. Hell yeah.
Awesome. Well, you guys take care. Hope you enjoy this episode of The Glass Blower's Companion. And until next time, we'll talk to you soon. Love you so much. Take care. Peace.